I'm supposed to give a little talk about serendipity, and I would like to show you how serendipity has found a place within our concept and our systems. And a lot of the things which have been discussed this morning and yesterday, you will see that the way we approach it and our vision and the way we look at the developments, that we try to give that a place. And that place should be in balance, we think. If you discuss serendipity, let's start with looking at what value creation basically is, and value creation in networks. Let me give you an example. If you have a hand of raw coffee beans, you have a commodity. If you burn them, you turn it into a product, you put them into a supermarket with other coffees and cream, and then it turns to be a service. And if you drink that coffee at a Starbucks coffee shop, then all of a sudden you have an experience. The key thing what's happening is that a hand of raw coffee beans of 3 cents all of a sudden becomes a latte macchiato and you pay €8 for it. So that's where you see if you increase and you move from one level to the next, your value is increasing tremendously. And whether it's monetary value or social value, I mean, that's another question. The key thing is that after you have had an experience numerous times, you know, it loses your interest. And there was that professor this morning, and he said, we are ready for a transformation, for a changing person. So the next level in value creation is that basically you need an experience which is tailor-made for you, which has you learn something from it, and then all of a sudden it changes you as a person. And then we achieve a transformation, and we think that achieving transformation as a network or a organization is the next step, and that gives you a distinct advantage about others. The key thing is, if you want to make an experience which is tailor-made with an educational element, and if it's concerning people and groups of people, people must meet unexpected, relevant other people. Because if you meet somebody you don't know before and he turns out to be very relevant for you, you learn something from him, it's an experience especially made for you and it changes you. It makes you a better professional or a better person or a better supplier or whatsoever. Now that unexpected but relevant experience, that's what we call within our organization serendipity. So let's have a look at this world. Can you make serendipity, although it's supposed to be unexpected, can you make it work? Can you make it work for you to achieve within network transformations? And I think the sharing economy or collaborative economy is capable of doing so. And if we are capable of doing that, we can easily work together with those larger platforms. The discussion was, are the big platforms the 1%, as Jeremiah Ouyang said? Do we have to compete against them? No. Some of those platforms will be there, and they will be there to stay. Some of those platforms are not sustainable. And as soon as we have found something better, an alternative, we move away from them and move on to the next. Let's not forget that we're in a transitional period. We're moving from one era to the next. So that doesn't mean that Uber will be there in 5 years, or even Google will be there in 5 years. I mean, there's no guarantee whatsoever. However, if you look at those platforms, we see a difference between technology, trading, communication platforms, and we think there is space, there's room for something new, and we call that a competence platform. And I will elaborate on that a bit later. If you look at the potential of networks, and in this case, I projected the Airbnb locations of New York. I mean, those are big numbers. I didn't even put in Wimdu or Couchsurfing. So that means there are groups of people from outside cities moving into those cities. These are the numbers for Amsterdam. Any big city basically is becoming something like a hotel, but it's spread out over the city. And that means if we are capable of connecting all those local sharing initiatives with all those visitors from outside towns, you get a whole new kind of economic dynamic. In the Netherlands, where I'm from originally, we have a lot of sharing initiatives, you know, like we share everything, basically, like tooling, like gardens, like food, like your living room, etc., etc. That's not the big thing. The key thing is that all those initiatives are working basically locally, and they're operating by themselves. And they're trying to build up their own audience instead of collaborating within the collaborative economy. Besides Seeds to Meet, we also launched shortly we launched shortly an initiative called Shareify, and that's supposed to be the couch surfing, but then for co-work spaces at people their houses. And yes, we do believe strongly in shared ownership, and we can't wait until the blockchain technology and guys like Martin with Lazus are ready so we can integrate that within our organization. And yes, I think that at a certain stage, the community or the sharers can take over, they can do a buyout, and the whole IPO stuff will be something from the past. What we have done so far is trying to use the abundance, and we have convinced corporations to collaborate with us and to share their abundance for what we call free or social co-working. That means you can get into those spaces. You don't have to pay for your co-working seat monetary, but you pay by social capital. You pay by the willingness to share your knowledge with other people you're meeting over there. And you can find now those locations at corporate offices in the Netherlands. We have schools, we have hospitals, we have libraries, we have theaters, etc. And we are linking all those spaces with abundance. We link them together, and we link all those people who are co-working there together. And what you see is that there's a new kind of collaboration arising between, let's say, the free agent and the co-workers and the traditional employees. And then you get all of a sudden a new kind of dynamic. That's fascinating to see. So if we are capable of joining forces, you will see that there are, let's say, production circles, economic circles, like maker circles or knowledge circles, circles where individuals are using every now and then those platforms. They use services from each other. But all those individual circles in those neighborhoods, combining local people with visiting people, they're connected through the networks as we know them, like Facebook and LinkedIn. And in other countries, they have their own versions. But you see a gap over there. So what we want to do is to connect people who don't know each other, but we know what people are relevant to other people once they're within our ecosystem. And that's very easy because we visualize the social capital. If you come in and you book your seat, you have to tell the audience who you are and what capabilities and knowledge you have to share. And we visualize that, and in that way, we enhance serendipity, and we're not the only one. This is called a ratio finder, and if you go out on a Saturday night in San Francisco, you can immediately see on what, let's say, hospitality locations, there's a surplus of male and female. And that means you're improving your opportunity for relevant meeting of people at that point. The KLM is doing the same thing. They call it Meet and Seat. Being a Dutch company, they saw Seats to Meet and they thought, well, let's call it Meet and Seat. But they're matching you with other travel companions on board. So if I'm traveling from Amsterdam to Brazil, I can select my traveling companion. And if he or she agrees, we can have an interesting conversation during our flight. And since all the planes are almost the same, they're almost like Boeing and Airbuses and whatsoever, it's going to be in future physical spaces, it's going to be in future the most important thing, who do you meet there? Are the people you are meeting and you didn't know yet, are they relevant for you? And that makes you come back and go back and to back. So we visualize that, all that information we have, we call that Seeds to Meet Connect, and it's shown on every device, and it's very simple. It's showing who is around you and what knowledge they have to share. And you can contact them. And the system using intelligent software is matching you. So it's almost like a dating engine. And I can assure you it works very well. So in that case, basically, we have found a new balance between the social capital and the monetary capital. Because as those networks of people, they meet each other, they're relevant for each other, all of a sudden they start new companies. They start new ventures. They start new projects, and then they need office space, they need meeting space, but then they have generated income, so they can pay traditionally for their meeting and office spaces. And in that way, starting with the social capital and starting with collaboration and sharing, we move slowly then all of a sudden, let's say, to the sustainability of the model, so there's also money to be made. And then there's a new balance, and we've been doing this since 2007, so it shows you that we really have found a sustainable way of somehow connecting the collaborative economy with the traditional organizations and what will be left of the traditional economy. So our concept is used for numerous purposes, and I must say that a lot of different companies we never thought of all of a sudden start to use the concept for their own purposes, which is fine, because the larger the network is, you know, the better it will operate and it will work. So the next step we are making now is connecting all the Dutch sharing initiatives together. Because if someone books a seat at 10 a.m. at Seats to Meet, the Seats to Meet system knows that at 9 a.m. they are in need of transportation. But the car sharing company doesn't. So if we can combine that and we can share that data at that moment, then all of a sudden the economic network is growing and is becoming really so big that it's starting to make a difference. I don't mention the word money, because on the sharing stuff in this case, nobody makes extra money. But it makes the whole network more connected, thus more powerful. And then all of a sudden, you see we can make a difference. After you have visited 3 times the Seats to Meet location, obviously you're still working on the project. So we can contact you with other people who have a working knowledge of coaching startup companies or venture capital and stuff like that. And if you still work there at 6 at night, we can offer you meal sharing services around you, around the physical location. So there are a lot of combinations to be made if we from the collaborative economy really start to collaborate with each other to begin with. Then all of a sudden you will see an enormous boost in services, and then we can really make the difference with each other. It works. Let me share you as my last slide some data with you. I mean, over the past 2.5 years, we handled more than 1 million seats. So we're accumulating data. It's really starting to work, and it's learning us really how the dynamics of bringing the old and the new together starts to work. We also had scientific research of the Rotterdam School of Business, and really people who are within our ecosystem after 6 weeks, either they have a new job, they start a new company, they start a new product, at least they become a better professional because they're learning from each other. They start to collaborate with people they didn't know before. So the serendipity is noticed really by our audience, and that's great. That can only grow. And it helps us too, because we no longer are in need, let's say, of sales and marketing and PR activities. We are no longer a traditional organization. Seats to Meet International, with figures like that, active in 6 countries, is being operated by 4 people, of which I am one of the 4. And the rest is done by the network and in collaboration with the network. It's not my network, it's our mesh, and we just have access to it. We don't see it as a community. We see it as a group of connected people who are working together on various levels and products. It's like really like a mesh in that respect. So have a look at it, think about it. And the last thing I want to mention is that somehow we have found a ratio between 1 seat we share. Somehow due to asynchronous reciprocity, we get 3 paid chairs back. So the more successful, let's say, the social capital sharing is, the more successful the whole model is becoming and making it more sustainable. Since as long as we have to pay taxes, you need money every now and then to make the whole thing work. If you have any questions, I will be around. I brought with me 2 of my colleagues, Marielle and Vincent, they're there. And you're more than happy to take a free download of my book, Society 3.0. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ronald, for this inspiring talk and positive talk.